This tutorial is part of our practical database design course. You can find a link to the YouTube playlist for this course in the video description. Alternatively, if you like this course, you can watch the complete course uninterrupted, ad-free, access updated tutorials and download the source code and more from our Udemy course. Again, the link to the course is in the video description. In this tutorial, we're going to explore table and field naming, the conventions, and what some might consider good practices. A naming convention, as I have described it, is a general agreed way of naming things. So I don't like the word things, so I've described them as objects. If possible, generally, it is a good approach to think about naming at the start of your project. Again, only if that is possible, and for you to generate a general set of guidelines, which can then be used by yourself and maybe the team, so that you're all working towards the same goals, same targets, and same set of rules. A naming convention might include, for example, defining where capital letters might be used in names, or potentially where spacing might be considered or used. In addition to that, you may have a rule which defines how you present the names. So, for example, there are many ways, many formats in which you can present names. In this tutorial, I will highlight some of these different formats that we can use. There are some names associated to these formats so that you can explore this further should you wish to. The terminology that we use is also going to be important, but more important is that we're consistently using the same terminology. So if we define that a user is going to be called user, not person or subject, then we need to make sure that we're consistent throughout our database and we name things appropriately and consistently. There is a great deal written about naming conventions, and you can read up on some of the different approaches. But ultimately, you want to create a naming convention which makes sense to you and your team. Most importantly, you are consistent in how you apply these rules, and you try and make those accountable for maintaining them. Taking time to think ahead and outlining standards is well worth the time. There are many different benefits that we can attribute to a good naming convention and consistently applying it through your project. Baking these benefits down and then some additional benefits here, ultimately it comes down to the fact that it makes it easier for you to work with that database. It makes it more consistent. Potentially you're saving time. Time is money. Many of these benefits may not resonate with you at a small scale, but once you start working on a much larger project and there's multiple parties interacting with a database or application, their naming makes a little bit more sense and it can have a much deeper impact in the development process. Although I have previously mentioned this, if there were just one piece of advice that I could give you, it would be to choose consistently. Be consistent on your choices and make sure you apply them consistently throughout your project. So far, the message is that we should try to develop a naming convention, if possible and if appropriate, at the start of the project so that everyone will follow that convention as we start to develop the application or database. The reality is that you can choose whatever standard or work in any way that you like. Now, you will have some limitations, and those limitations will be set by the software that you're using. Databases will have some limitations on the types of characters that can be used or the lengths of values or characters that you can use in names. More importantly, and above all, we apply our naming standards or convention consistently throughout the project. So although I'm not committing to telling you exactly how you should create a naming convention, there are some common questions that you'll typically ask yourself when building your own naming convention. If I were to leave you in a room with this advice that I've given you so far to develop a naming convention, I can guarantee you would eventually stumble upon the following questions. So based upon what I've said so far, I can answer all of these questions with the same answer. Maybe. But let me give you some more information which might help you answer some of these questions. So the first question, should table names be plural? I guess that depends on how you look at the table, how you interpret the table. A table, What is a table? Well, a table holds multiple rows. So that is suggesting this idea of plural, the fact that the table will store multiple records or rows. So it doesn't, in this case, this table doesn't hold a student. This table is holding data about students. So if you follow that theme, that approach, that idea, then maybe tables should be named plural. So this table should be called students, which really then suggests or defines the data that's going to be within this table, multiple students. It's going to be a decision that you need to make. And just remember that if you do use singular or plural, just be consistent throughout the whole database. So should column names be singular or plural? I think this one is a little bit clearer. And again, it's your own preference, but when you start to actually look at a table and name some of these attribute or fields with plurals or utilizing plurals, you can start to see it doesn't necessarily make sense in some instances. For example, when we query this data, let's just return one row from this table here. And this is then suggesting that this field here is storing student IDs, which it isn't. It's only storing one ID. So it doesn't necessarily make sense, or it doesn't necessarily describe the data that's being returned or is going to be stored within that field utilizing this kind of plural approach. So in general, in this case, my preference would be to use singular. So I would use student ID, subject fee, rather than fees. At least in my opinion, I think it makes a little bit more sense for that. And again, having the foresight and understanding that in order to retrieve this data, I'm going to need to make queries. I think in that perspective as well, it makes a little bit more sense to use a singular approach when we're actually generating these queries. So another common question, should I prefix tables or columns? So I think this question can be very situational, maybe depending upon the technology potentially that you're using. So for example, if you were implementing a database, for example, using the Django framework, then you wouldn't necessarily need to specify a prefix because it would do that for you. Whereas some other technologies, it doesn't do that for you. Maybe that's what you want to achieve. So you are kind of having to explicitly define a prefix. And then in some cases, you may choose not to use a prefix because the technology provides other tools such as aliases. So you can then apply that to the fields, for example, to essentially rename those fields or utilize that particular name and associate it with that field to make it easier for you to interact and remember names for fields, for example. So this question doesn't necessarily have a very straightforward answer and can be very situational because sometimes you don't need to actually assign or provide a prefix. And I'll explain what that is in a second because of the technology that you're using. For example, if you're using the Django framework, you won't need to specify a prefix. It does that for you in actual fact when you migrate your tables to the database. And in some other technologies, you might want to define a prefix. But you don't necessarily have to because you can also utilize a field alias. So there are definitely different options, but a prefix. So what we're suggesting here, this is a classic example. Imagine we had multiple tables. These tables all had the same field name in that table, which is name. So we know that the product has a name field. We have a category that has a name field, and there might be other tables that have a name field. And there's a general rule that we want to try to ensure that we don't duplicate the field names throughout the database, or some try to achieve this. So utilizing a prefix allows us to change the name of the field to make it unique for that particular table. So you can see what I've done here is I've taken the name of the table, I've abbreviated it, and then I've created this prefix to the name. So now in every single table where there's a field name, it will now have this prefix. Now, that isn't just going to be applied to the name field. Any other field within that table will also have that prefix. So I'm going to try and be consistent throughout that table and throughout then my database. Now, some might consider that it's a little bit excessive to utilize this prefix on all of the fields or unnecessary. And also, there are some considerations potentially when we want to make changes in the future to the table. It can make it potentially more difficult to work with the table if there are prefix used. So I would recommend reading around if you are considering this type of approach and try and weigh up the benefits and drawbacks. Now, I haven't mentioned table prefix. So in addition to fields, here we see this type of prefix, and this doesn't necessarily have to be in this format. The prefix can be in many different formats, but we can also have a prefix on the table name. Now, as we have already learned in this course, the actual entity name, the table name, should be unique throughout because we're modeling attributes of a particular entity, and that entity should be unique throughout the database. So there shouldn't be many occasions where potentially there are table names or entities that are going to be needed to have the same name in your database. So using a prefix for your table in this instance probably isn't going to be necessary. Where you may choose to use a prefix for a table is when you potentially have a project that is utilizing multiple databases. But in more general terms, prefix in a table name, not generally, and prefix in a column, some do, some don't. So the last question, should I use capital letters for naming or in naming? Again, as long as you're consistent, you can use capitals, of course you can, and there's lots of different formats or known formats that you can utilize for naming your tables and fields. Camel case, Pascal case, lower camel case, snake case, and kebab case, for example. These are just some of the formats that you can follow when naming. Do make sure that you have a look at your relational database management system documentation, because that will also guide you in relation to what characters or special characters can be used in naming. Generally, I try to avoid special characters because it can make it a little bit confusing. Again, consistency will win, but generally we want to try and avoid utilizing special characters. In addition to that, generally, database names should start with a letter, or consider always starting with a letter, and also consider any database case sensitivity. Again, just check out your database documentation for that, but generally things will be case sensitive. And then the last point to consider, consistent terminology. So if you choose a name for a user, be that root, admin, super user, prime user, just make sure that you're consistently using that throughout your project. So the summary is very much what we previously mentioned. Develop a naming convention at the start of the project if you can. Be consistent in how you apply it throughout the project. Of course, you can choose your own standards, but there are certain approaches, certain ways, you know, formats, lowercase, lower camel case, snake case, kebab case. So there are standards out there. There are known approaches out there for naming conventions and formats. So it's well worth having a little bit of research before you start and committing yourself to one of these approaches. And then the last point, which has been the theme throughout this tutorial, apply the standards consistently. Be consistent in how you apply your naming throughout your project.